Hello, everyone. Welcome to another edition of Where the 99 Lead, a program brought to you by the University of Pikeville, where we discuss many different topics surrounding the University of Pikeville. Both academics, the Kentucky College of Optometry, the Kentucky College of Osteopathic Medicine, of course, the Colleges of Business and Education, and all things regarding academics at the University of Pikeville. But today, we talk athletics. Joined by UPike Athletics Director Robert Staggs in studio. And Robert, welcome again to Where the 99 Lead.
It's good to be here, Andrew.
Robert Staggs, Athletics Director at the University of Pikeville, and that's a busy gig. We'll talk about that, but first, let's talk about your background. You've been associated with Pikeville for several years, and I'm going to jump out there and age both of us and say decades.
Couple of decades, yeah. I would imagine.
A couple or more. Robert, of course, you spent time as a student at Pikeville, then Pikeville College, as well. Talk about that, and then your first gig as an employee at the university.
Well, Andrew, of course, you know I graduated from here. Played a little basketball. Actually, came back, started playing baseball. And then they ended up dropping that program, which right. you were a member of. And so after that, I stayed on and played basketball for Greg White, and finally graduated. And I was been doing some stuff in sporting good business. And Wayne Alberry called me and asked me to come and help him with the baseball program.
Yes.
So I started back when we started the baseball program back. I started back as an assistant baseball coach, and then Roy Cutright was our women's coach in basketball. And so Roy asked me to help him with basketball. So basically, I've been here ever since.
Sure. And you've worn many different coaching hats while at the University of Pikeville. Of course, a successful run as the softball coach that comes to mind immediately. And I know your love for that game. And is that the sport you enjoyed coaching the most?
It is. Basically, it's outside. You get outside. You're away from the office. A lot of times I'm out. When I'm out on the field, it's stress release.
Sure.
Get out and get to cut grass, work on the infield and all that. And I really don't like anybody helping me do that because it is very stress. It's a stress relief for me.
Absolutely.
But it's a great sport. I absolutely love it. I'm looking forward to this spring. So
I know it is one of your loves, a passion of yours. You've also spent time with the volleyball program. And it's something that I know you personally didn't have experience with except for family reunions.
That is it. It was funny because when Ron Dameron, who was our AD at the time, had our softball / volleyball coach, Missy Gregg, had left in the middle of a year, sure. Or right after a volleyball season, to go to Milligan. Well, they didn't have anybody to coach softball, so I'm still assistant women's coach with Bill Watson, and Ron calls me in and asked me if I would be interested in coaching softball for that spring. I said, well, sure. So I started coaching softball, and then next thing I know, he's calling me in his office during the summer and said, what do you know about volleyball? And I said, well, Ron, basically you have to hit it three times to get it over the net.
Uh-huh.
And he said, well, how would you like to coach volleyball and softball? I said, well, I'd love to.
Right.
So that first year, I was head volleyball coach, assistant women's basketball coach, and head softball coach.
Yes.
So that year absolutely killed me. But, you know, that summer, I went to three or four camps, college camps. I went up to Muskingum College. I went to University of Kentucky hung out down there with their coaches for about three or four days and basically learned volleyball
right.
and had a ball with it.
Yeah, coaching is coaching. and then you have the details of each sport. A lot of it are management skills, mm-hmm. managing the players and being able to relate to the players, and then you have details of each sport, and you've proven that you can take on nearly anything that comes your way. I know you've also spent time in other situations on an interim basis with some other sports. Talk about some other sports that you've coached.
Well, the one that comes to mind, and Rick Bentley and I laugh about this all the time, is soccer.
Yes.
You know, I had to finish, we had a coach that left towards the end of the season, and I stepped in as interim men's and women's soccer coach. Tell you right now, didn't know a thing about soccer.
Yeah.
Still don't.
Yes.
You know, I know what offsides is and all that. I kid around with some of our players about it, but for about a half a season or a quarter of a season, I was our interim soccer coach, and our last tournament games, I believe, that year was at University of the Cumberlands. And as soon as we got beat out, I walked over to Rick. I said, "Rick, I resign."
Yes.
He said, "You can't resign. I've already quit."
Yeah. You got it. Robert Staggs, athletics director at the University of Pike, but longtime member of the UPike campus in many different roles, beginning as a student and spending time coaching on the sidelines at the University of Pikeville, now the head of the athletics department as athletics director. And Robert, here we are halfway through the 2016-17 academic year. There's a lot to talk about when it comes to UPike athletics. Several teams now heading into the spring semester, still on holiday break from classes. But let's talk about a couple that have been busy during the holiday break. Both bowling and basketball have spent time traveling and competing during the break. Tell us how those teams spent their time away.
Well, you're right, Andrew. It's kind of a dead time for us right now. Fall is usually when everything's going on. You have kids coming on campus. You have football starting up, volleyball, both cross countries, and golf is starting up, a lot of things going on in the fall, and it's kind of slowed down now. We've had basketball's going on, or women right now have jumped up to number 24 in the country. Men jumped up to 12. So Kelly took his bunch down to Miami over the break and won a couple of big games. And then our bowling, our women's bowling program has been, and I don't mean as a pun, but they've been on a roll here.
Sure.
You know, they've won two tournaments over break and had a couple of our players been named Mid-South Conference Players of the Week. And it's been fun for us over break. And we're actually ready for kids to get back on campus and get ready to start this second semester.
Travel becomes much more regular now as you begin conference play, but I know a Florida trip, it involves a lot of details, and there's some funds involved as well with that travel, but the bowling teams, I believe if I look at it per mile, they travel more than any other team out there is because they have no home lanes.
That we have no home lanes bowling wise yet, and they do some fundraising as far as travel goes, but we do have a home tournament, so to speak, but it's in Dayton, Ohio.
Yes.
I mean, it's kind of tough on them, and they are road warriors. It's I don't know how they do it, but they go to Vegas. They travel to Ohio quite a few times, Indiana, Illinois. I mean,
right. They're known all over the country.
They are.
As one of the premier bowling programs. Robert Staggs, UPike Athletics Director, our guest on this edition of Where the 99 Lead. Of course, bowling and basketball busy during the holiday off season. Kelly Wells, just before the holiday break, of course, became the all-time wins leader at the University of Pikeville, the winningest coach in UPike history, going back through the days of Pikeville College. Tell us about that honor for Kelly, and tell us what Kelly, talk about his time here on campus since he arrived.
Well, Kelly's been here 11 years, and we've had some great coaches over the years. And I'm not just talking about men, I'm talking about women's too. And, to to break Billy Watson's record. And you know, I love Bill dearly, and I was a big part of a lot of his wins.
Yeah.
You know, Kelly won 243 games. Now it's 245, where he won two over Christmas. It's just phenomenal. It's just to a testament to the type of guy Kelly is, to the type of kids he recruits. If I'm not mistaken, it's probably around 22, 23 wins a year.
Right.
And you know, to do that over that amount over 11 years it's something. And it's also a testament to Kelly for being here 11 years. You know, it's a lot of people use UPAC or Pikeville College UPAC as a stepping stone. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's just a testament to Kelly to stay around for 11 years to be able to do that.
I'll never forget the first meeting of Kelly Wells as the head coach of then Pikeville College, and I asked him the question, because he was coming to us from Hawaii.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing Kelly's background, he's an Eastern Kentucky guy in Moorhead, and of course, Sean also from our region. I knew the ties to the region, but you have to ask the question, all right, why do you leave Hawaii to come to Pikeville? And his response, I think, is one of the reasons he's still here after 11 years and the success he's had and could be coaching many different places. He said it's about family.
Mm-hmm.
And being closer to family. And I think that's been proven, not just in his words, but in his actions, that he's a family person, and UPike becomes family in addition to his relative family throughout the region.
It does. And you know, and Pikeville's a perfect fit for Kelly and Sean. It's halfway between her home and Kelly's home in Moorhead. And, you know, she teaches over the elementary school, and she's a big part of there, Kaylee and Mason are growing up and becoming pretty good athletes in their own right, I hope this is home for Kelly.
Right.
I mean, I'm sure he's had some opportunities in the past to leave, and I'm sure he may have an opportunity here shortly to leave.
Sure.
But you know, this is Kelly's home, and this is where they want to stay.
Regardless, he is the all-time wins leader at the University of Pikeville, and his name now etched in the history books with the likes of Bill Watson, Roy Cutright, Paul Butcher,
mm-hmm.
Randy McCoy, Wayne Martin. You think of all the names that have walked the sidelines as the head coach of the University of Pikeville, both men and women, and there's some quite successful coaches in that list, and Kelly Wells now sits atop that. We talk football. Al Holland Jr., still what we consider a young coach in a very young program, and they claim the Mid-South Conference Football Championship this fall, and a historic win at Georgetown, first ever over that program. What does it mean for the program to earn that championship?
Well, Andrew, it really breaks my heart to beat Georgetown.
Yeah.
And knock them out of the playoffs.
Sure, it always does.
It does. I mean, I shed a tear, you know.
Yes.
But no, Al has done a phenomenal job. It's his third year as our head coach. And you just forget that, you know, he's been here while he was here with Dudley for a few years. But,
right.
You know, you forget, you know, Al's fairly young as far as coaches go. And he's done an outstanding job, and to finish 6-5 in the Mid-South Conference is saying something. And especially this is our first year of winning a conference championship. We finished tied with Georgetown, but actually, you know,
if you win the head-to-head,
we're head-to-head, we're champions.
That's not a tie.
That's not a tie in our book. And you know, knocking them out of the playoffs was extra special.
Sure.
But beating them on the last game of the season on a, as Joe Kinzer would call it, a walk-off field goal.
Yes.
was just awesome.
You better believe it. Great win, and it has to change the program. I talked to Coach Holland after that win and after the regular season. What does that mean? And when you go on the road recruiting, I don't think those that are tuned in understand the competitiveness of Mid-South Conference football recruiting when you have Georgetown coming after the best players. You have Campbellsville, you have the University of Cumberland's, you have Union, and you have Pike, UPike, and you have UVA Wise. You've got a lot of schools coming after the best of the best in that region. It's very competitive.
It is, and you know, and I don't really know how they do it. You know, we have 11 football coaches, and they go, they're all over the place.
Sure.
And as soon as the season's over, you don't see them. And, you know, they're going from Florida out to California and everywhere in between. And it's just, it's amazing to me. But the Mid-South is, people don't, I don't think they realize how good of a conference it is. And I'm not just talking football. I'm talking basketball, baseball, sure, softball, volleyball. I mean, it is a tough conference, and you know, to compete in it is saying something. And what Al has done, and the type of kids he's brought in, you know, not only has he brought in good football players, he's brought in good people. You know, these are great kids he's brought in, and you know, we're very proud of them.
And obviously, as the athletics director, one role for you is you have to keep an eye on the academic side of the athletes and those programs as well. And I know when you see the all academic teams come out, and when you see the teams' academic combined cumulative grade point averages, those are something you keep a close eye on and take a great amount of pride in, because these are student athletes and the student part comes first.
You're exactly right, Andrew, and that's what we preach to our kids all the time, is you're a student athlete, and our main goal is to get these kids on campus and to get them a good education. You know, all that other stuff comes second, and you know, football, athletics, or whatever, it's a means to an education. Mm-hmm. And you know, we love to see our kids walk across camp or walk across that stage every May. Our student athletes' GPA is higher than the regular student athletes overall, or the regular students overall. You know, we take pride in that. We've had this so far. We have 28 academic All-Americans, and we've had 28 Mid-South All-Conference, academic All-Conference. We've had 9 so far academic All-Americans. The past two years, we've had close to 100 of our kids, or 75 of our kids have been Mid-South Academic All-Conference, and we've had 35 to 40 academic All-Americans. And that's just, you know, that's just a testament to our coaches and the type of kids we're bringing in.
It's a big deal, because these kids, these young people, they spend a lot of time on the road. They spend a lot of time on the practice field, on the playing field, on buses, traveling here and there throughout the conference, and yet still able to maintain their academics. They're getting their work done. They're getting their study halls, and able to perform in the classroom as well, because 99% of these young people will not go on to play at the next level and play professionally, but their profession will be as a nursing student, or moving on to the business world, or moving on to a med school, or what have you. Perhaps they'll land in Washington, D.C. as one of our lobbyists or congressmen. I know we've had recently football players that have spent time as interns in Washington and fell in love with the place. That's a little frightening that anyone would fall in love with the place, but it's been proven. But we've got those academians out there that are student athletes, mm-hmm, and so proud. And I always love being able to talk to those athletes out of uniform when they're sitting here and you're just talking to them as students, and you see they have as much passion about what their studies are as about the games they're playing.
Yeah, we've been fortunate to have our faculty that will work with our kids. Our faculty are great as with working with our kids. As you know, as long as they know, you know, when we're leaving, when, you know, what we're going on, they bend over backwards to help these kids. You know, as long as they're going to class and doing what they're supposed to be doing in the classroom, our faculty bend over backwards to help these kids.
Sure.
And we could not do what we do without them. But yeah, it's amazing to see. You know, you have kids come back 10, 15 years later, and what they've made of themselves. You mm-hmm. know, they're either We have some attorneys, we have doctors, we have surgeons.
Sure.
And it's just, it's great to see how our student athletes go out and better and better themselves and better this world. It's a good thing. It's a good feeling.
Robert Staggs, UPike Athletics Director, our guest on this edition. And football signing day coming up. It's just around the corner, the first week of February. How will UPike welcome those new recruits to campus?
Well, it's first Wednesday in February, and what we've been doing is we'll bring all our kids that are going to sign. They come on campus that day with their parents and whoever else they want to bring, and we have a stage set up and tables and stuff set up in our hoops indoor practice facility, and all these kids come, and President Webb will say a few things, and we'll get up and say a few things to them, and all these kids come and sign in front of their peers. It's a good thing. We'll provide them lunch. We usually get it from a cafeteria, and it usually takes two and a half, 3 hours, and all the media will be there, area media, and it's a big day. It's a big deal for them.
Absolutely, and of course, photo opportunities, and I know you see a lot of proud family there with those players that are moving on to the next level, and that's a dream for many of those young people that are moving on from a high school career to become college athletes. That's the day that marks the beginning, and you see a lot of pride.
You do, and especially, especially these kids that are first generation college students.
Sure.
Their parents swell up with pride, and it's fun. It's a good day for us.
Absolutely. Robert Staggs, UPike Athletics Director, our guest, and you've spent time on the diamonds at the University of Pikeville. We think of baseball and softball as spring sports, but in college athletics, spring sports typically get started in the cold, dark days of winter. If it's not the preseason with throwing and running and those type of things, sometimes the games are played under not so ideal situations because of the length of schedule and when tournaments happen. To be able to get games in, you battle Mother Nature. You battle snowflakes from time to time. Baseball and softball, their seasons begin in February. What do you expect from these programs this year?
Well, Andrew, you've been there, so
yep.
you know exactly what you're talking about. But we'll start baseball and softball as soon as we get back on campus on the 16th or 17th. We're inside, and baseball's crazy. They start middle of February. I at least start at the end.
Yes.
I get on our baseball coaches all the time. It's snowing 3 feet out there, and we're playing. I'm like, you guys are stupid.
Yes. It's really not baseball weather.
It is not baseball weather, but we open up, softball-wise, we open up the last weekend in February. We go down to Buford, South Carolina, and play a couple schools down there. And baseball actually opens up the weekend before. They go to St. Andrews over in North Carolina,
right,
and play. And then once we get back, then it's the beginning of March. It's still typically winter.
Yeah.
So it's hit or miss.
Yeah.
I'm not much of a cold weather person. My players kid get on me all the time because I absolutely freeze it.
Yes.
Anymore. I keep heaters. We keep heaters in our dugout. It sounds like a jet engine. You
uh-huh.
can't hear anything in our dugouts. So baseball came off, is coming off a great year last year. Jim Pitt has done a phenomenal job with our baseball program, and couldn't be more happy with Jim, and proud of Jim and what him and his staff have done, and we're looking for a good year for them, and I'm looking for a good year of softball. So,
and basically in a 2 month season, there'll be 40, 50 games played, and you've got to fight around the weather to do that. Softball, of course, very competitive in the Mid-South Conference, as is baseball. They're two of the premier conferences in the country. Always you have the top teams in the country. A couple of those every year will be from the Mid-South.
You're exactly right. And, on the softball side of it, we have Lindsey Wilson and Campbellsville, who normally they're top 10, top 15 programs. On the baseball side of it, you have Cumberland University, who won the daggone thing a couple years ago.
Right.
I mean, and Campbellsville. I mean, it's a grind once we get started, because, you know, softball, we're allowed 28 dates. So we normally play doubleheaders.
Right.
Baseball, you're allowed 56 games. So we're trying to get 56 games and 28 dates in 2.5 months.
Yeah.
And you're battling the weather, and, you know, sometimes it's tough. And, you know, both of us have our schedules fixed, so, you know, our kids aren't missing many classes.
Right.
But, you know, of course, when you're depending on the weather, you know, things happen.
Indeed.
So,
track and field at U-Pike is expanding. Tell us about those opportunities.
Well, right now, starting next week, I'm going to be interviewing for our track and field coach. We really don't have a track and field coach, and we really haven't used it as we need to. And President Webb wants to expand it, so we're going to hire a coach, and we're going to go out and go full bore with it. We want to bring in we'd love to bring in about 50 kids.
Sure.
to compete. Now, no, you know, I don't think Bob Amos is a regulation track force, but, you know, we can practice up there. But, you know, going out and running 3 or 4 meets in the spring is plenty. We're enrollment driven. And so we want to help with our enrollment with athletics. So it's a no-brainer for us to start to ramp up our track and field.
And another new program that will fall into the athletics department is archery. I know it's had a successful start on the high school level. I would imagine that's just a natural transgression.
It is with us, Andrew. You know, we dropped over the fall. We dropped lacrosse, women's lacrosse.
Right.
You know, we went through 3 years with it and went through 4 coaches and barely got to play 1 season. And it just wasn't a good fit for us here in Eastern Kentucky.
Right.
There's no schools around us that play.
Sure.
But, you know, we started looking, and archery, you know, there's over 100 schools within 2 miles of us, or not 2 miles, but 2 hours, 2.5 hours of us that have archery.
Yes.
And, you know, with the amount of hunters we have around here, you know, these kids get out.
Sure.
I mean, it's a no-brainer for us. And right now, Dan White and I are in the process of interviewing coaches. Hopefully we'll have someone in place within the next week, couple weeks, to get out and start recruiting these kids and bringing them on campus for next year.
Indeed. Robert Staggs, U-Pike Athletics Director, a busy guy at the University of Pikeville. How many sports now at U-Pike?
We have 22.
22 sports. And there are many people that may have only known. Well, you see the big ones. You see football. You see basketball, both men and women. 22 sports. And at some time, more than half the student body at the University of Pikeville were student athletes.
Still
Does that
is.
Hold true?
Still is.
Wow.
Over half, about 50, 52, 54% of our undergrads are student athletes.
Wow. It's a big number of student athletes, and of course, student comes first. Getting it done in the classroom and on the fields and courts at U-Pike. Robert, thanks for being with us.
Jordan, Andrew.
Have a great spring semester, and let's go Bears.
Let's go.
You've been tuned to Wear the 99 Lead, a program brought to you by the University of Pikeville, the leading university of Central Appalachia.